The Pulse School on RealAgriculture.com is brought to you by Saskatchewan Pulse Growers and Nodulator XL.
I guess where we started out with this project is that a lot of the literature we have regarding different inputs for field peas looks at maybe one or a combination of two inputs at most, but we really didn't have a comprehensive study that looked at how various inputs interacted to affect pea yields and seed quality. So what we did is we looked at what inputs, I guess, are that the farmers are most often considering or looking at spending those extra dollars on. And what we did is we applied them alone as well as in combination to assess the interaction of those inputs. So the inputs that we chose for this particular study was seeding rate. So we had a low versus a high seeding rate to target a recommended plant population. We used foliar fungicides, seed treatments, starter nitrogen fertilizer, and then a granular inoculant instead of a liquid inoculant.
So what were some of the findings from your study?
Well, I've looked at most of the site years so far, and we seem to have trends that our trends are divided in between high-yielding and low-yielding sites. So at our high-yielding sites, overall, when we look at all of our treatments together, we generally see a response to three inputs, and that's using a higher seeding rate, foliar fungicides, and granular inoculant instead of a liquid inoculant. And those three inputs generally increase yields at the high-yielding sites when applied alone and are additive when you apply more than one of those three inputs in combination. So as we increase as we add an additional inputs at those high-yielding sites, we generally see a greater yield potential, and we actually see less yield variability. So adding more inputs will actually stabilize the yield at high-yielding sites such as Scott or at Melfort. At our low-yielding sites, which was generally Swift Current, and actually at Indian Head, where we did see at Indian Head, we had a phantomyces kind of take over some of the plots. But at Indian Head and Swift Current, which we characterize at our low-yielding sites, we actually really got a large yield response to a high seeding rate. And then on top of that, adding additional inputs didn't really seem to increase yield any further. So we seem to be maximizing yield potential at those low-yielding sites with a higher seeding rate, and nothing else that we could throw at it could really maximize yield beyond that.
Were there any inputs that you noticed were simply doing nothing?
Well, starter nitrogen fertilizer was kind of an interesting one. When applied alone as the only input, we actually saw a yield improvement, but only at the low-yielding sites. And I'll talk about that in a bit. But at our high-yielding sites, starter nitrogen fertilizer didn't really have any significant yield increase. And actually, sometimes it reduced yields in certain situations, and I think that it's because it may have reduced the nodulation of the plant. So not generally recommended as an input that you want to focus on. The only situation where it seemed to be beneficial was at our very low-yielding sites when it was the only input applied. And I think what's happening there is that maybe there's issues with nodulation, and that starter nitrogen fertilizer was actually enough to supply the crop throughout the growing season. But it's, as soon as we're adding other inputs in the combination, that benefit seemed to dissipate. So starter nitrogen was kind of not really a very reliable input. Seed treatment as well didn't seem to have a large effect on yield response. Now I know guys looking at seedling diseases you're not going to want to skip out on their seed treatment, but there was other inputs, I guess, that had a more stable return on investment than our seed treatment.
So you did look a little bit into investments and economics of all these inputs?
Yes, we did the economic analysis last year, and I have yet to do it for this year, but what we do want to show farmers is that, we want to look at which combination produces the highest yield. But, there's difference. You want to make sure that the extra cost of seed or the extra cost of the fungicide application is going to pay off in the end. So we will be doing an economic analysis to make sure that, we're not only getting a yield response, but we're also getting a return on that investment.
Sure. So when can we expect the all of the results compiled together?
By Christmas time, we should have the results compiled, and I'm hoping eventually we can also get the research published as well. It's quite a large study, so I'm hoping there'll probably be a couple papers that come out of this project. So.
And is there anything concrete that you're already able to use in terms of suggesting things to farmers?
I would say across all of the sites, what I've seen is that using a higher seeding rate to target a recommended plant population, that's kind of the one thing that you want to make sure that you do is make sure that you have an adequate plant population to start that crop off right. And I think that goes a long way in terms of maximizing your yield potential. If there's disease pressure there, or if you have a crop that looks like it's going to yield quite well, I would go in and spray with foliar fungicide, because at our high yielding sites, they were very responsive to a foliar fungicide. Granular inoculant as well seems to pay off, not quite as consistently as seeding rate and foliar fungicide, but that would be kind of the next input that I would tell guys if they're looking to spend a few extra dollars an acre, that would be where to put your money.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.